say, web applications with ReasonML and GraphQL. So I'm going to give you an introduction about ReasonML is a bit, not too much, because it's really, it's a new syntax, so it's a little different than what you're probably used to. But before I start, I want to thank you all for being here, and also, like Berlin has a special place in my heart, because actually it was here in 2015. I was at a hackathon, and I first used GraphQL and React together. So for me, it's always special to come back and think about these moments and how they really defined the last 3 years of my, especially my professional career. So what's this for? I'm not sure if a lot of people of you are using type systems in their projects, but if you aren't, then it's especially interesting to see what I have to tell to you today. So do you know what a date is? So a date can be a lot of things, right? I've made some examples of what a date could be. So a date could be today, so it's the 21st of June, you're all here at this conference. But also a date could be a dried fruit. And a date can be many other things. It can also be like the word date created with this dried fruit. So a date can be a lot of things. And also, I really like this scene from one of my favorite Disney movies. This is also a date. So a date can be a lot of different things. So when you're programming and you have to work with things, it can be a lot of different things. It can get really frustrating. So in programming, you can say a date maybe is like a date object, or maybe it's actually a string, maybe it's a timestamp, or maybe it's something else as well. So you really have to think about what your date actually is. And that's why I really like type systems, because with type systems, you already know what your date is, because you defined it somewhere yourself. So you always know your date is like a date object, or maybe it's a string, maybe it's a timestamp you created. So you always know for sure that your date is a date, and that's something you would want. So let me tell a little bit about myself as well, so you actually know who's standing here and speaking for you. So my name is Roy. You can find me on all sorts of social media. I work on a lot of different things. So most of my time I spend on working for the City of Amsterdam, where we're building all these projects with Python, JavaScript, and we also recently started adopting GraphQL. So there's actually a government using GraphQL in production, which is quite cool. I also teach at the React GraphQL Academy, where we tell people how you can actually use React and GraphQL together and get started with these technologies. And I worked for some other companies as well. So let's get started by looking at ReasonML. I don't know if any of you have already heard about ReasonML. Are there people that already know it? Okay, so that's quite a few. I hope you don't know it too well. Maybe you know it even better than me. That would be a bit strange. Okay, so let me tell you a bit about Reason. So this is actually from the website, so I copy-pasted it, so nothing special in there. But it lets you write simple, fast, and quality type-safe code. So as you can see, we've got the types in there, and you've got the quality, and simple and fast. So we're going to see about the simple and fast later on. But what I really want to highlight is the quality type-safe. Because type safety is important, as you saw before, and the level of type safety in Reason is very different from the ones you see in TypeScript or maybe other type languages. And there's more in there as well, but we're going to get back to that later on. So it's mostly due to the type system, which I shortly briefed. And it's just like GraphQL, because in GraphQL you get the type system as well, right? So probably when most of you started using GraphQL, you looked into all the demos, you used some playgrounds, and you ended up with something like this. So you have a mutation, and you want to put some variables in there, and then you try to put a product ID that's actually a string. And then you probably run into some errors. So the first time you use GraphQL, you were probably, oh, what's happening? I've got no idea why this error actually is there. So this is because of the type system. And you can imagine if you're working with something like ReasonML that is typed, you get these errors all the time when you try to run stuff, and it really makes it easy to debug. So a little comparison between the two type systems. So on the left, you can see actually Reason types, and on the right, you can find types in GraphQL. So you can already see some small difference, but mostly they look a lot the same, because we've got a type that's called Review, and we've got a type called Review in GraphQL as well. We've defined those color types, which is strings and floats. And also, if you look at the order type that actually combines like your non-scalar types, like Review, you can see it's quite the same, right? So you're making a list. You can also make an array of another type. So there's a lot of similarities in there, which is actually quite cool. And something that I really like about Reason is called our variants. I'm not going to get into detail what actually variants are, but they look like your enums in GraphQL. So you got yes, you could no, you could limited, and stock will be one of these things. And you can actually find out which of these things it is by going through the code. But there are a lot of similarities, as you can see. So we'll get back to leveraging the JavaScript and OCaml ecosystems. So one thing that's really cool about Reason, you can actually use it together with JavaScript or with OCaml. So you're not really tied to just Reason. You also have the the possibilities to use other languages in there as well and other packages, which makes it really versatile. So Reason actually is like an extension or a superset, how you depends on how you want to call it. Most of the time it's a tool chain based on top of OCaml with some small syntax differences, but most of it is actually OCaml. So you can find a lot of similarities in there, and actually like 99% of the code is the same. And the big advantage of using Reason is you compile it to JavaScript, or you can compile it back to OCaml. You compile it to other things as well. As you can see here, we're using something called BuckleScript, and with BuckleScript, you can actually run Reason code, you can compile it, you can transpile it, you can do a lot of things with it in there. And you can compile it to other things as well. So it is especially going to be interesting, because at one time, once we all start using WebAssembly, you can probably compile Reason to WebAssembly as well and use that ecosystem. So that's all quite interesting to learn more about. So a small comparison between if you're using JavaScript for your web application and you're probably seeing this and thinking, hey, I already use Flow, I already use TypeScript, why should I use Reason? Well, Reason is a bit different from TypeScript. Actually, it's it looks less like JavaScript, so it's a more new syntax. And also, its type system is better. And better is like a strange word to say, but in my opinion, it's better. So I like the type system better. And also because Reason has a lot of functionalities that you don't have in TypeScript. So here are some. So you've got types in TypeScript. TypeScript is more functional than normal JavaScript. But still, Reason is really functional. The build system is really fast. And we're going to show you that later, like how fast you can compile things. And something I like, it's immutable, like out of the box. You can have immutability in JavaScript as well. But most of the time, you would need like an external package to do this, or you need to hack something in there. But Reason is immutable by default. And something I really like is the pipes. So you actually have pipelines when you try to define things, so you no longer have functions, a set of functions, and functions, and functions, which can get quite complicated in the end. So just pipelines. And pattern matching, it's helping you with the variants I showed before. And something that's I briefly talked about already is the interoperability, so interop. So basically, this means you can use JavaScript in your Reason code, and you can actually use Reason in JavaScript as well if you want, but it's a whole different topic. So that's why they sometimes call Reason the JavaScript of 2030, because all these things that JavaScript developers love is actually already in Reason. So things as said like the pipeline or the interoperability, all these things, it's already in Reason. So that's really interesting about the language. So I don't know if you ever look at the ECMAScript proposals. There are a lot of things in there, and a lot of things that are actually in there are either inspired by Reason or other functional programming languages like Elm. So it's really interesting to get into these things. But let's get back to GraphQL, because that's why we're here, right? So I'm going to try and consume a GraphQL server with Reason. So I'm going to use some things for that, and mostly I'm going to use just Reason. So as you can see right here, it's actually really easy to install. And you can just use Yarn or NPM if you're already familiar with JavaScript. So the thing I want to do, you need to globally install the BS platform, and that's actually the BuckleScript platform. So this is the one that's going to help you running, transpiling, do all sort of things with your code to make it readable for your browser. And then you can just start a new project by just inning it. And you can see we've got different types of themes. So there's actually a theme for React Hooks. So later on, when I show you my demo, I already have React Hooks in there and all these things that are available in React. And then you can just go into the project and run Yarn. It will install some things. And Yarn start to actually start the compiling. And then you would get an application like you could see on the right. So this is actually the starter kit, the sort of create React app for Reason. And in here there are some things. So one thing, it automatically creates some components for you. And you can see we've got two different file extensions. So the one is .reason, and the other one is a compiled version from BuckleScript, which is actually JavaScript that can be run by Webpack and then in your browser. And every time you start running, you start changing your code, it actually starts compiling, and that's something that's really fast, because sometimes it takes a lot of time when I'm working on JavaScript to actually compile things and wait for my browser to actually see the changes. But Reason, it's way faster. So we've got these two file types, right? So the .bs, .js, they're automatically created. You don't have to fiddle with that. But you can look at it and really see what it compiles to. We can do it later on in the demo. And there's another something that's different. It's the .merlin file. And this is actually the file that's really going to save your life if you start writing Reason. Because the people in here use VS Code, I recently started using it. I was really skeptical about it because I used Atom first and didn't want to have an opinionated IDE. And then I started using it because I did my reason and I really liked it. So with your .marlin file, you actually get support like syntax highlighting, auto-suggest. Without it, it don't work. So you really need the .marlin file. And then we got the bsconfig file. In there, you would define all the things that are related to BuckleScript. And you just have a package of JSON in which all your NPM modules will be installed. So it looks pretty similar to how a React application would look like if you use that for your web applications. And then it comes to the most interesting part, because to run GraphQL inside of Reason, you would need an extra package. And that package is called GraphQL PPX. And you would need to add it to your BuckleScript config, and then you will know, BuckleScript will know you're actually using GraphQL PPX. And you can just use NPM or Yarn to install this. And the nicest thing that I really like about this one, you can actually send the introspection query to your GraphQL server. So whenever you run this command, it will automatically pull your server, it will go to your server, it will take your schema, and it will actually compile your schema to type systems, to type variables that Reason understands. So as you can see on the right, there is some defined over there. We're going to get into more detail into that thing later. But this actually is going to help you bringing end-to-end type safety into your project. Because sometimes you really rely on your backend server. And if you have a GraphQL server running and you need to define your types by hand, you get a lot of errors because you don't really know what kind of types are running there. Maybe someone changed things, maybe stuff got deprecated. So it's really interesting, it's really important to actually run this introspection query and get the latest version of your schemas every time you run your code. And with that one, so let me tell you a bit about what a PPX is. So with a PPX, you can use an AST or an abstract syntax tree inside Reason code. So it's a bit dissimilar to the one used in GraphQL tag. So that's the one I put on the right. So if you've been using GraphQL in your JavaScript project, you probably use GraphQL tag, right, to have the GraphQL query language inside of your JavaScript code. So it's the same for Reason. But then you can use GraphQL query language inside your Reason code. And that's why you need a PPX to do this. So yeah, you can actually parse this tree and actually use it inside of your project. And then, as you can actually use this type inside your code. So as you can see on the right hand, so on the left, you actually define your query. So we've got a products query. You want to have a title, a thumbnail. We also have some nested values in there as well. And on the right hand, you can see what this actually would compile to. So you would have seen there's a type. It's called products type. It would have a title, which is a string. It's a thumbnail, which is also a string. And reviews, which basically is an array or a list of flowed items. So these are the exact same type that would be defined in your schema. So it makes it really convenient to work with these two languages together because you don't need to define all by hand and you're always sure that your types will match. Yeah, so the sharing the type is, for me, it's one of the most important reasons when I thought about using Reason with GraphQL. Because I used it with TypeScript before and there are packages to help you with this, but you're also really, you're tied to a specific package, and GraphQL PPX, it's a bit different because it's actually a PPX and nothing more. But only if it was just that simple, right? Because you can probably imagine, oh, this is cool. I'm importing my types and everything is well now. I can just use Reason code and it will always work with my GraphQL server. So there are some customizations you might have to do if you're running with complex schemas, or maybe you want to actually alter your types that are defined in your schema. Maybe they need to be extended. Maybe you want to use fragments. Or maybe you actually want to spread those types in different types. It would get more complicated. So you might want to define the type yourself again. And yeah, it's because of the limitations, right? Because it can't be always the same because you're using two different languages, you're getting a schema, but your schema might change, and your schema might isn't really suitable to be used on your entire web application because maybe you extended your schema somehow. So that's why you need to have some customizations in there. So that's something you could do with the BS record. So whenever you add BS record, you can override the products type that is linked to this one. And then the nice thing with Reason is you don't have to define a specific type name. It doesn't really matter. It's in here, we're going to have a query that's called products. But maybe you want to have your type called apples or pears. It doesn't really matter because Reason will automatically detect what kind of structures look the same, right? So they're going to look for a type that you've defined that has a title, a thumbnail, reviews, and reviews that could be a list and array. So Reason automatically will check all these things to actually know what kind of type you would have to define for this. And then you can actually define it yourself. So on the right side, I've defined an example of what this could be. And you could actually extend this one, right? So that's a cool thing to do, because if you just use the types that are created by the GraphQL PPX, you can't spread them. So that's something that could be interesting, because you want to reuse a lot of your code, and that's why spreading of types could be an interesting thing. Yeah, and also that's kind of a cool thing to do as well. So it's going to check for your type. It's going to find a structure that matches. And if a structure doesn't match your query, you're going to get runtime, you're going to get compile errors. So that's interesting to see as well. So you still have some type safety, because every time you you make some changes and it doesn't really fit a type, you will get errors. So you're really you're forced to actually make your types work with your GraphQL server. Yeah, but something else that I tried to figure out, because I wanted to make a demo for you and I wanted to make it as simple as possible, so I thought, okay, I'm not going to use any external packages instead of GraphQL PPX. But then, as Reason is a functional code, it isn't that declarative. So if you want to have code that looks nice for a demo, it's kind of hard to do that in a functional programming language, and especially in a syntax that probably most people can't read. So I started creating this one, and I ended up with a lot of boilerplate code. So just to give you an idea, so it took me like 38 lines of code to actually make a function to fetch my GraphQL server, just to send a body in there that would be the parsed GraphQL query. It will go to there, it will use promises, the promise need to be resolved, or maybe you will get errors if your promise don't resolve. So that's about 38 lines of code. So if somebody really likes to be competitive, maybe we can do some pair programming later and see if you can do it in less. It could be interesting. And then it took me like 22 other codes just to have a reducer just to go to my different kind of states, right? Because you've got loading, once you've sent the query, then you've got data back, so maybe your data has an error. So that's like 22 lines of code to actually make this work, to send the request to my server, and all these kind of things. It was like 22 lines of code. So I guess on this screen it will probably, yeah, to be readable, it would already have filled the entire screen. And then you got some more things I need to define, like types for the loading indicators, like some other types as well. I ended up with over 100 lines of code just to get a simple GraphQL request in there. So that's why they probably made packages to make this more declarative. I finally understand. So I ended up with using Reason and Polo. And in there, there's already a lot of these boilerplate code that I had to create myself for this demo. I threw it away and I just used Reason Apollo, because it's easier to show you what this actually is about, because I don't want you to understand the syntax from Reason after this. I want you to understand why you could actually use Reason in your next project. So Reason Apollo, it just uses GraphQL PPX. So the send introspection query using the query language, it's already in there. So you don't need to put it in yourself. Okay, so actually to install this, you can just use Yarn again or npm install. So it's really convenient, and if you're migrating from a different language, it isn't that hard. And the only manual thing you need to do is adding them to your bsconfig. So that's kind of a step I don't really like, and probably there will be like packages to help you do this automatically. Maybe we can write a small CLI to do it. But you would add it to your BS dependencies, and as you can see with the PPX flags, we still have the GraphQL PPX in there. So we can still read the GraphQL query language inside your Reason application. Okay, so let me show you the demo I've created. So first, I've created this small server in CodeSandbox. Let me see if it's still running, because that's kind of important. Okay, so we've got this one running. And as you can see, I've got a schema defined in here. It's quite basic. As you can see, we've got a product defined, we've got some types of product. We also got products also linked to review and to offers. So these are all types I've defined, right? And we want these types to be readable by Reason, and we can actually use them in Reason's type system. So that's why I needed to send the introspection query, like we saw in the slides. And when I send this introspection query, it's going to create a new file for you. So that's this file. It's a representation of your GraphQL schema, but in JSON. Let me get back to this. Yes, if we go to the top, you can actually see your schema is defined here. We've got queries and mutations. So we don't have any subscriptions in here yet. And then you can actually see what is defined, right? So we have a query defined, or a query can query for products, and products will return a list. So this is already made into types for you. You can actually use a Reason code, so you no longer have to do this yourself. So as you can see, we've got products, it's a list, and it's a list of different variables, right? So if you've got an ID, it's a scalar type, it's an integer, all these things are already in here, so you don't have to duplicate any code yourself. You can just browse through it, and you will find everything that's defined in your schema is already defined in this file to be readable by reason. A demo what we would have an index file, and just the only thing we're doing here, we're using a Reason Apollo provider. And this provider will serve as provider for everything that's related to your GraphQL client. And this GraphQL client is defined in here, right? So it's nothing that's too hard to understand. So you've got some in-memory cache, so that's a nice thing as well. As I said before, Reason works very well together with the entire JavaScript and OCaml ecosystem. So actually by using this package, you can already use all the Apollo features, like in-memory cache or create HTTP link. And we just create a client over here, right? So this is the code sandbox I've got running with the GraphQL server. And we use it as a server for this demo. And then I can see in package.json, I've defined the things to actually start the server. So once you go to your terminal, there are some things you need to do, right? So at first, we need to run yarn start because you want Buckle script, which is right here. So actually run our code, compile it, and make it readable for the browser. So that's just running yarn start. And as I can show you, it's already compiled. It said no work to do because I run this demo before just to make sure it works. But you can actually try it and run yarn clean so you can see actually how fast it works. So now we're going to clean everything. So as you can see, all our compiled files are gone, right? So we don't have any compiled files by Buckle script anymore. And then you can just run yarn start again. And we actually start compiling these things. So you can see it's 240 milliseconds to compile this code on the left. So it's quite fast. And then actually to run this one, you can just run a yarn server. And as you can see, it's going to start Webpack. And with Webpack, you can actually use this code. So it's already quite familiar if you've worked with JavaScript. And then we can see in the Webpack configuration on which port or code is available at. So it's 8000. So if once you go here, I probably already have it running. Yeah, so this is actually a small demo. Sorry, I'm not a designer. I just tried to keep it functional as I'm talking about a functional programming language. So let me see what it does, right? So we've got products defined. And these products are coming from our GraphQL server. So we've got this blue t-shirt. It's offered by some retailer. So we've got like a big fashion giant selling it for €8 and $8, sorry, and then we've got other products as well, right? And then we can actually add stuff in there. So maybe we want to have test. Maybe it's selling for that price. I can see it's automatically added here. We've got some nice success message, and an offer is added to the list. So this is all made by Reason, and it uses our GraphQL server to get the actual data. And how that works, so like I said before, we've got our index file, and here we link our client to the provider. So now we can use this GraphQL client from anywhere in our code that's nested in here, right? So we've got these app components. And as you can see, it's just using a JSX-like language. So it's really easy for you to understand if you've used JavaScript before. So as you can see, we've got our app file. OK, let's look for it. And that's something nice as well, because in Reason, it will automatically detect where your file is. So we don't need to import anything, because Reason will know where this app file will be. And as you can see, it's here. And it's just showing the title of this one. And then it will return a component called products. So if you're interested about how this would compile, it looks something like this, right? So this is the JavaScript that's generated by it. And in here, you can see it's actually going to require the component. It's going to take the Buckle script version. And then it's going to create an element with React. And it's actually going to mount the title in there. And it's going to make the app. So it's nothing that should be that strange if you already worked with React before. So what's more interesting, actually, is this one. So this is the products component. As you can see, make it a tag bigger. And in here, you can see we're actually using the GraphQL PPX. And here, we've defined our query. And this query looks like this, right? So we have a named query called getProducts. And with this one, we're going to get products. And products has an ID. It has a title. It has offers. And offers have their own types as well. So we're just going to get this one, and it's automatically linked to this one, right? So as you can see, we've got title here. Maybe if we change title to name, it's going to give us errors because Name isn't there in your type. So in your GraphQL schema, name isn't defined for product. So you automatically get these compile errors inside your VS Code. So that's really cool, actually. It's going to really make the developer experience to work with is really really fun, because you don't need to go to your browser or to your terminal to actually see the errors. You just get them right in here. And I know you can do the same with TypeScript, but for TypeScript, I don't know, it's not really that functional as Reason is. So I don't know, let's change it back to title so we can actually have working code. Yeah, so it's going to keep giving errors until I've defined something. And now you can see title is a string, as it should be. ID is there as well. Okay, so then we're going to use Reason Apollo to create a query. So this one is get products. And we're going to create a query based on this one. And you can also see types in there. And then we can just use this React component, right? So we have this React component. And in here, it's already, we've got a switch statement. And something I really like about Reason as well is the switch statement. So in JavaScript, it's really, it's a lot of code to make a switch statement. In here, it's quite easy, because you just have switch, result, and if it matches our variant like this, we've got loading, we want to display loading, we want loading to be a string. And this is where the pipelines come in as well. So you don't really need composition anymore, you just put in two strings. So we're going to turn this string actually into string that can be displayed by Reason. And then we've got to do the same for error message. Maybe we want to get the error message. And we would get like a nested field like this. So again, the syntax can be quite confusing in the beginning, but yeah, it's more about the bigger picture, right? So we've got a response, and a response, we want to get products from there. So as you can imagine, if you've got this query defined, you can imagine what it looks like, right? So we would get a data object, data would have products, products would have ID, title. There would be another field in there that's called offers that I think is an array. And this is just like your JSON response. So we need to actually parse this and use it. So we just got a response, it would be data. We would get the products field from there. And then we know it's an array, so we want to map it, right? So we want to map this product. And you can see which fields are available. So we've got ID that's available, which is an integer. We also have title that's available, and that's a string. And then you can just use them in there, right? So we're going to iterate over this list. We're going to define the products in there. As you can see, we've got a title. And then we've got two other components we're actually using it. It's going to give me some error. I'm not really sure why. I can try and debug it later. So we want to try and show the offers. So we're just going to send an offer prop to this component. And we also want to show a form. And we probably need a product ID for that form, because we want to know, we want to let the server know to which product actually the offer should be added. So that's basically how this code was created, right? So we've got the product title, and then we're displaying the offers and the form. And these would have their own components. So as you can see in here, you can look at the offers first. It's just a simple component, right? So we're doing nothing strange in there. We're just going to get the offers, which was sent to it, and we're going to iterate over it, and we're going to display it. And as you can see, you've got all these nice things in here. So maybe we try to get ID from offer. If you would want to change this, so maybe to product ID, I think this one is actually available. Either way, if you were trying to put stuff in there that isn't available, you would get errors in here, like. And you also have the auto-suggest syntax, which isn't working that well today. That's quite nice. Live coding, yay. Okay, so then what we're doing here as well, we have the resellers and we have the price. So it's nothing too interesting in here. So what's more interesting is actually this one, where we're using a query. So if you have a query, if you have a mutation, sorry, you actually want to send variables to that mutation, right? So you would define your variables in here like this. And this is just a GraphQL query string. So if you would copy-paste this one, you would put it in the server, it would probably work. And then we would just use this one. You can see I've defined some states in here, just the React hooks that I used that are available in Reason as well. And you would have these controlled components for inputs. I would just go through this code, and you can submit it. And yeah, it's nothing that interesting to see, actually. But I've got this demo online, so I can show you the link later on. So then, as I see, I don't have that much time anymore. So probably while we're asking, should I use Reason? I think most people don't want to use Reason right now, right? But I do hope a lot of people actually would want to start using type systems. Because as you can see, it's really convenient to actually find the types. And with, if you use something like Reason, you could have end-to-end type safety. And the same is possible with TypeScript if you use the right packages. So yeah, definitely start using type systems because yeah, they're going to add a lot of value to your developer experience, and also they're going to help you make more robust applications that have less runtime errors, or actually, with reason, no runtime errors. So yeah, if you want to have the code, you can use this QR code. And thank you very much for listening to me.